Emile, or On Education, by Jean-Jacques Rousseau. Translated by Barbara Foxley. Read by Jonathan Booth for Ukemi Audiobooks. Author's Preface. This collection of scattered thoughts and observations has little order or continuity. It was begun to give pleasure to a good mother who thinks for herself. My first idea was to write a tract a few pages long. But I was carried away by my subject, and before I knew what I was doing, my tract had become a kind of book, too large indeed for the matter contained in it, but too small for the subject of which it treats. For a long time, I hesitated whether to publish it or not, and I have often felt, when at work upon it, that it is one thing to publish a few pamphlets and another to write a book. After vain attempts to improve it, I have decided that it is my duty to publish it as it stands. I consider that public attention requires to be directed to this subject, and even if my own ideas are mistaken, my time will not have been wasted if I stir up others to form right ideas. A solitary who casts his writings before the public without any one to advertise them, without any party ready to defend them, one who does not even know what is thought and said about those writings, is at least free from one anxiety. If he is mistaken, no one will take his errors for gospel. I shall say very little about the value of a good education, nor shall I stop to prove that the customary method of education is bad. This has been done again and again, and I do not wish to fill my book with things which everyone knows. I will merely state that, go as far back as you will find a continual outcry against the established method, but no attempt to suggest a better. The literature and science of our day tend rather to destroy than to build up. We find fault after the manner of a master, to suggest we must adopt another style, a style less in accordance with the pride of the philosopher. In spite of all those books, whose only aim, so they say, is public utility, the most useful of all arts, the art of training men, is still neglected. Even after Locke's book was written, the subject remained almost untouched, and I fear that my book will leave it pretty much as it found it. We know nothing of childhood, and with our mistaken notions, the further we advance, the further we go astray. The wisest writers devote themselves to what a man ought to know, without asking what a child is capable of learning. They are always looking for the man in the child, without considering what he is before he becomes a man. It is to this study that I have chiefly devoted myself, so that if my method is fanciful and unsound, my observations may still be of service. I may be greatly mistaken as to what ought to be done, but I think I have clearly perceived the material which is to be worked upon. Begin thus by making a more careful study of your scholars, for it is clear that you know nothing about them. Yet if you read this book with that end in view, I think you will find that it is not entirely useless. With regard to what will be called the systematic portion of the book, which is nothing more than the course of nature, it is here that the reader will probably go wrong, and no doubt I shall be attacked on this side, and perhaps my critics may be right. You will tell me, this is not so much a treatise on education as the visions of a dreamer with regard to education. What can I do? I have not written about other people's ideas of education, but about my own. My thoughts are not those of others. This reproach has been brought against me again and again, but is it within my power to furnish myself with other eyes or to adopt other ideas? It is within my power to refuse to be wedded to my own opinions and to refuse to think myself wiser than others. I cannot change my mind. I can distrust myself. This is all I can do, and this I have done. If I sometimes adopt a confident tone, it is not to impress the reader, it is to make my meaning plain to him. Why should I profess to suggest as doubtful that which is not a matter of doubt to myself? I just say what I think. When I freely express my opinion, I have so little idea of claiming authority that I always give my reasons, so that you may weigh and judge them for yourselves. But though I would not obstinately defend my ideas, I think it my duty to put them forward, for the principles with regard to which I differ from other writers are not matters of indifference. We must know whether they are true or false, for on them depends the happiness or the misery of mankind. people are always telling me to make practicable suggestions. You might as well tell me to suggest what people are doing already, or at least to suggest improvements which may be incorporated with the wrong methods at present in use. There are matters with regard to which such a suggestion is far more chimerical than my own, for in such a connection the good is corrupted, and the bad is none the better for it. I would rather follow exactly the established method than adopt a better method by halves. There would be fewer contradictions in the man. He cannot aim at one and the same time at two different objects. Fathers and mothers, what you desire, that you can do. May I count on your goodwill? There are two things to be considered with regard to any scheme. In the first place, is it good in itself? In the second, can it be easily put into practice? With regard to the first of these, it is enough that the scheme should be intelligible and feasible in itself, that what is good in it should be adapted to the nature of things, in this case, for example, that the proposed method of education should be suitable to man and adapted to the human heart. The second consideration depends upon certain given conditions in particular cases. These conditions are accidental and therefore variable. They may vary indefinitely. Thus, one kind of education would be possible in Switzerland and not in France. Another would be adapted to the middle classes, but not to the nobility. The scheme can be carried out, with more or less success, according to a multitude of circumstances, and its results can only be determined by its special application to one country or another, to this class or that. Now, all these particular applications are not essential to my subject, and they form no part of my scheme. It is enough for me that, wherever men are born into the world, my suggestions with regard to them may be carried out, and when you have made them what I would have them be, you have done what is best for them and best for other people. If I fail to fulfil this promise, no doubt I am to blame. But if I fulfil my promise, it is your own fault if you ask anything more of me, for I have promised you nothing more. Book 1. God makes all things good. Man meddles with them, and they become evil. He forces one soil to yield the products of another, one tree to bear another's fruit. He confuses and confounds time, place, and natural conditions. He mutilates his dog, his horse, and his slave. He destroys and defaces all things. He loves all that is deformed and monstrous. He will have nothing as nature made it, not even man himself, who must learn his paces like a saddle horse, and be shaped to his master's taste, like the trees in his garden. Yet things would be worse without this education, and mankind cannot be made by halves. Under existing conditions, a man left to himself from birth would be more of a monster than the rest. Prejudice, authority, necessity, example, all the social conditions into which we are plunged, would stifle nature in him and put nothing in her place. She would be like a sapling chance sown in the midst of the highway, bent hither and thither, and soon crushed by the passers-by. Tender, anxious mother, I appeal to you. Footnote: the earliest education is most important, and it undoubtedly is woman's work. If the author of Nature had meant to assign it to men, he would have given them milk to feed the child. Address your treatises on education to the women, for not only are they able to watch over it more closely than men, not only is their influence always predominant in education, its success concerns them more nearly, for most widows are at the mercy of their children, who show them very plainly whether their education was good or bad. The laws, always more concerned about property than about people, since their object is not virtue but peace, the laws give too little authority to the mother. Yet her position is more certain than that of the father. Her duties are more trying. The right ordering of the family depends more upon her, and she is usually fonder of her children. There are occasions when a son may be excused for lack of respect for his father, but if a child could be so unnatural as to fail in respect for the mother who bore him and nursed him at her breast, who for so many years devoted herself to his care, such a monstrous wretch should be smothered at once as unworthy to live. You say mothers spoil their children, and no doubt that is wrong, but it is worse to deprave them as you do. The mother wants her child to be happy now. She is right, and if her method is wrong, she must be taught a better. Ambition, avarice, tyranny, the mistaken foresight of fathers, their neglect, their harshness, are a hundredfold more harmful to the child than the blind affection of the mother. Moreover, I must explain what I mean by a mother, and that explanation follows. End of footnote. You can remove this young tree from the highway and shield it from the crushing force of social conventions, tend and water it ere it dies. One day its fruit will reward your care. From the outset, raise a wall round your child's soul. Another may sketch the plan. You alone should carry it into execution. Plants are fashioned by cultivation, man by education. If a man were born tall and strong, his size and strength would be of no good to him till he had learnt to use them. They would even harm him by preventing others from coming to his aid. Left to himself, he would die of want before he knew his needs. Footnote. Like them in externals, but without speech and without the ideas which are expressed by speech, he would be unable to make his wants known, while there would be nothing in his appearance to suggest that he needed their help. End of footnote. We lament the helplessness of infancy. We fail to perceive that the race would have perished had not man begun by being a child. We are born weak. We need strength. Helpless, we need aid. Foolish, we need reason. All that we lack at birth, all that we need when we come to man's estate, is the gift of education. This education comes to us from nature, from men, or from things. The inner growth of our organs and faculties is the education of nature. The use we learn to make of this growth is the education of men. What we gain by our experience of our surroundings is the education of things. Thus, we are each taught by three masters. If their teaching conflicts, the scholar is ill-educated and will never be at peace with himself. If their teaching agrees, he goes straight to his goal. He lives at peace with himself. He is well-educated. Now, of these three factors in education, nature is wholly beyond our control. Things are only partly in our power. The education of men is the only one controlled by us, and even here our power is largely illusory, for who can hope to direct every word and deed of all with whom the child has to do? Viewed as an art, the success of education is almost impossible, since the essential conditions of success are beyond our control. Our efforts may bring us within sight of the goal, but fortune must favour us if we are to reach it. What is this goal? As we have just shown, it is the goal of nature. Since all three modes of education must work together, the two that we can control must follow the lead of that which is beyond our control. Perhaps this word nature has too vague a meaning. Let us try to define it. Nature, we are told, is merely habit. What does that mean? Are there not habits formed under compulsion, habits which never stifle nature? Such, for example, are the habits of plants trained horizontally. The plant keeps its artificial shape, but the sap has not changed its course, and any new growth the plant may make will be vertical. It is the same with a man's disposition. While the conditions remain the same, habits, even the least natural of them, hold good. But change the conditions, habits vanish, nature reasserts herself. Education itself is but habit. For are there not people who forget or lose their education, and others who keep it? Whence comes this difference? If the term nature is to be restricted to habits conformable to nature, we need say no more. We are born sensitive, and from our birth onwards we are affected in various ways by our environment. As soon as we become conscious of our sensations, we tend to seek or shun the things that cause them, at first because they are pleasant or unpleasant, then because they suit us or not, and at last because of judgments formed by means of the ideas of happiness and goodness which reason gives us. These tendencies gain strength and permanence with the growth of reason, but hindered by our habits they are more or less warped by our prejudices. Before this change, they are what I call nature within us. Everything should therefore be brought into harmony with these natural tendencies. And that might well be if our three modes of education merely differed from one another. But what can be done when they conflict? When instead of training man for himself, you try to train him for others? Harmony becomes impossible. Forced to combat either nature or society, you must make your choice between the man and the citizen. You cannot train both. The smaller social group, firmly united in itself and dwelling apart from others, tends to withdraw itself from the larger society. Every patriot hates foreigners. They are only men and nothing to him. Footnote: thus the wars of republics are more cruel than those of monarchies, but if the wars of kings are less cruel, their peace is terrible. Better be their foe than their subject. End of footnote. This defect is inevitable, but of little importance. The great thing is to be kind to our neighbours. Among strangers, the Spartan was selfish, grasping, and unjust, but unselfishness, justice, and harmony ruled his home life. Distrust those cosmopolitans who search out remote duties in their books and neglect those that lie nearest. Such philosophers will love the Tartars to avoid loving their neighbour. The natural man lives for himself. He is the unit, the whole, dependent only on himself and on his like. The citizen is but the numerator of a fraction, whose value depends on its denominator. His value depends upon the whole, that is, on the community. Good social institutions are those best fitted to make a man unnatural, to exchange his independence for dependence, to merge the unit in the group, so that he no longer regards himself as one, but as part of the whole, and is only conscious of the common life. A citizen of Rome was neither Caius nor Lucius. He was a Roman. He ever loved his country better than his life. The captive Regulus professed himself a Carthaginian. As a foreigner, he refused to take his seat in the Senate except at his master's bidding. He scorned the attempt to save his life. He had his will and returned in triumph to a cruel death. There is no great likeness between Regulus and the men of our own day. The Spartan, Pedarites, presented himself for admission to the Council of the 300 and was rejected. He went away rejoicing that there were 300 Spartans better than himself. I suppose he was in earnest. There is no reason to doubt it. That was a citizen. A Spartan mother had 5 sons with the army. A Helot arrived. Trembling, she asked his news. "Your 5 sons are slain." "Vile slave, was that what I asked thee?" "We have won the victory." She hastened to the temple to render thanks to the gods. That was a citizen. He who would preserve the supremacy of natural feelings in social life knows not what he asks. Ever at war with himself, hesitating between his wishes and his duties, he will be neither a man nor a citizen. He will be of no use to himself nor to others. He will be a man of our day, a Frenchman, an Englishman, one of the great middle class. To be something, to be himself, and always at one with himself, a man must act as he speaks, must know what course he ought to take, and must follow that course with vigour and persistence. When I meet this miracle, it will be time enough to decide whether he is a man or a citizen, or how he contrives to be both. 2 conflicting types of educational systems spring from these conflicting aims. 1 is public and common to many, the other private and domestic. If you wish to know what is meant by public education, read Plato's Republic. Those who merely judge books by their titles take this for a treatise on politics, but it is the finest treatise on education ever written. In popular estimation, the Platonic Institute stands for all that is fanciful and unreal. For my own part, I should have thought the system of Lycurgus far more impracticable had he merely committed it to writing. Plato only sought to purge man's heart. Lycurgus turned it from its natural course. The public institute does not and cannot exist, for there is neither country nor patriot. The very words should be struck out of our language. The reason does not concern us at present, so that though I know it, I refrain from stating it. I do not consider our ridiculous colleges as public institutes, nor do I include under this head a fashionable education, for this education facing 2 ways at once achieves nothing. Footnote: there are teachers dear to me in many schools, and especially in the University of Paris, men for whom I have a great respect, men whom I believe to be quite capable of instructing young people, if they were not compelled to follow the established custom. I exhort one of them to publish the scheme of reform which he has thought out. Perhaps people would at length seek to cure the evil if they realized that there was a remedy. End of footnote. It is only fit to turn out hypocrites, always professing to live for others while thinking of themselves alone. These professions, however, deceive no one, for everyone has his share in them. They are so much labour wasted. Our inner conflicts are caused by these contradictions. drawn this way by nature and that way by man, compelled to yield to both forces, we make a compromise and reach neither goal. We go through life, struggling and hesitating, and die before we have found peace, useless alike to ourselves and to others. There remains the education of the home or of nature. But how will a man live with others if he is educated for himself alone? If the twofold aims could be resolved into one by removing the man's self-contradictions, one great obstacle to his happiness would be gone. To judge of this, you must see the man full grown. You must have noted his inclinations, watched his progress, followed his steps. In a word, you must really know a natural man. When you have read this work, I think you will have made some progress in this inquiry. What must be done to train this exceptional man? We can do much, but the chief thing is to prevent anything being done. To sail against the wind, we merely follow one tack and another. To keep our position in a stormy sea, we must cast anchor. Beware, young pilot, lest your boat slip its cable or drag its anchor before you know it. In the social order, where each has his own place, a man must be educated for it. If such a one leave his own station, he is fit for nothing else. His education is only useful when fate agrees with his parents' choice. If not, education harms the scholar, if only by the prejudices it has created. In Egypt, where the son was compelled to adopt his father's calling, education had at least a settled aim. Where social grades remain fixed, but the men who form them are constantly changing, no one knows whether he is not harming his son by educating him for his own class. In the natural order, men are all equal, and their common calling is that of manhood, so that a well-educated man cannot fail to do well in that calling and those related to it. It matters little to me whether my pupil is intended for the army, the church, or the law. Before his parents chose a calling for him, nature called him to be a man. Life is the trade I would teach him. When he leaves me, I grant you, he will be neither a magistrate, a soldier, nor a priest. He will be a man. All that becomes a man, he will learn as quickly as another. In vain will fate change his station, he will always be in his right place. Occupave te, fortuna, atque capi, omnes quae aditus tuos interclusi, ut ad me aspirare, non possess. The real object of our study is man and his environment. To my mind, those of us who can best endure the good and evil of life are the best educated. Hence it follows that true education consists less in precept than in practice. We begin to learn when we begin to live. Our education begins with ourselves. Our first teacher is our nurse. The ancients used the word education in a different sense. It meant nurture. Educit obstetrix, says Varro. Educat nutrix, instituit pedagogus docet magister. Thus, education, discipline, and instruction are three things as different in their purpose as the dame, the usher, and the teacher. But these distinctions are undesirable, and the child should only follow one guide. We must therefore look at the general rather than the particular, and consider our scholar as man in the abstract, man exposed to all the changes and chances of mortal life. If men were born attached to the soil of our country, if one season lasted all the year round, if every man's fortune were so firmly grasped that he could never lose it, then the established method of education would have certain advantages. The child brought up to his own calling would never leave it. He could never have to face the difficulties of any other condition. But when we consider the fleeting nature of human affairs, the restless and uneasy spirit of our times, when every generation overturns the work of its predecessor, can we conceive a more senseless plan than to educate a child as if he would never leave his room, as if he would always have his servants about him? If the wretched creature takes a single step up or down, he is lost. This is not teaching him to bear pain. It is training him to feel it. People think only of preserving their child's life. This is not enough. He must be taught to preserve his own life when he is a man, to bear the buffets of fortune, to brave wealth and poverty, to live at need among the snows of Iceland or on the scorching rocks of Malta. In vain you guard against death. He must needs die. And even if you do not kill him with your precautions, they are mistaken. Teach him to live rather than to avoid death. Life is not breath, but action, the use of our senses, our mind, our faculties, every part of ourselves which makes us conscious of our being. Life consists less in length of days than in the keen sense of living. A man may be buried at 100 and may never have lived at all. He would have fared better had he died young. Our wisdom is slavish prejudice. Our customs consist in control, constraint, compulsion. Civilized man is born and dies a slave. The infant is bound up in swaddling clothes. The corpse is nailed down in his coffin. All his life long, man is imprisoned by our institutions. I am told that many midwives profess to improve the shape of the infant's head by rubbing, and they are allowed to do it. Our heads are not good enough as God made them. They must be moulded outside by the nurse and inside by the philosopher. The Caribs are better off than we are. The child has hardly left the mother's womb. It has hardly begun to move and stretch its limbs when it is deprived of its freedom. It is wrapped in swaddling bands, laid down with its head fixed, its legs stretched out, and its arms by its sides. It is wound round with linen and bandages of all sorts so that it cannot move. It is fortunate if it has room to breathe, and it is laid on its side so that water which should flow from its mouth can escape, for it is not free to turn its head on one side for this purpose. The newborn child requires to stir and stretch his limbs to free them from the stiffness resulting from being curled up for so long. His limbs are stretched, indeed, but he is not allowed to move them. Even the head is confined by a cap. One would think they were afraid the child should look as if it were alive. Thus the internal impulses, which should lead to growth, find an insurmountable obstacle in the way of the necessary movements. The child exhausts his strength in vain struggles, or he gains strength very slowly. He was freer and less constrained in the womb. He has gained nothing by birth. The inaction, the constraint to which the child's limbs are subjected, can only check the circulation of the blood and humours. It can only hinder the child's growth in size and strength and injure its constitution. Where these absurd precautions are absent, all the men are tall, strong, and well made. Where children are swaddled, the country swarms with the humpbacked, the lame, the bow-legged, the rickety, and every kind of deformity. In our fear lest the body should become deformed by free movement, we hasten to deform it by putting it in a press. We make our children helpless, lest they should hurt themselves. Is not such a cruel bondage certain to affect both health and temper? Their first feeling is one of pain and suffering. They find every necessary movement hampered. More miserable than a galley slave, in vain they struggle, they become angry, they cry. Their first words, you say, are tears. That is so. From birth you are always checking them. Your first gifts are fetters, your first treatment torture. Their voice alone is free. Why should they not raise it in complaint? They cry because you are hurting them. If you were swaddled, you would cry louder still. What is the origin of this senseless and unnatural custom? Since mothers have despised their first duty and refused to nurse their own children, they have had to be entrusted to hired nurses. Finding themselves the mothers of a stranger's children, without the ties of nature, they have merely tried to save themselves trouble. A child unswaddled would need constant watching. Well swaddled, it is cast into a corner and its cries are unheeded. So long as the nurse's negligence escapes notice, so long as the nursling does not break its arms or legs, what matter if it dies or becomes a weakling for life? Its limbs are kept safe at the expense of its body, and if anything goes wrong, it is not the nurse's fault. These gentle mothers, having got rid of their babies, devote themselves gaily to the pleasures of the town. Do they know how their children are being treated in the villages? If the nurse is at all busy, the child is hung up on a nail like a bundle of clothes and is left crucified while the nurse goes leisurely about her business. Children have been found in this position purple in the face. Their tightly bandaged chest forbade the circulation of the blood, and it went to the head. So the sufferer was considered very quiet because he had not the strength to cry. How long a child might survive under such conditions I do not know, but it could not be long. That, I fancy, is one of the chief advantages of swaddling clothes. It is maintained that unswaddled infants would assume faulty positions and make movements which might injure the proper development of their limbs. That is one of the empty arguments of our false wisdom, which has never been confirmed by experience. Out of all the crowds of children who grow up with the full use of their limbs among nations wiser than ourselves, You never find one who hurts himself or maims himself. Their movements are too feeble to be dangerous, and when they assume an injurious position, pain warns them to change it. We have not yet decided to swaddle our kittens and puppies. Are they any the worse for this neglect? Children are heavier, I admit, but they are also weaker. They can scarcely move. How could they hurt themselves? If you lay them on their backs, they will lie there till they die, like the turtle, unable to turn itself over. Not content with having ceased to suckle their children, women no longer wish to do it. With the natural result, motherhood becomes a burden. Means are found to avoid it. They will destroy their work to begin it over again. And they thus turn to the injury of the race, the charm which was given them for its increase. This practice, with other causes of depopulation, forebodes the coming fate of Europe. Her arts and sciences, her philosophy and morals, will shortly reduce her to a desert. She will be the home of wild beasts, and her inhabitants will hardly have changed for the worse. I have sometimes watched the tricks of young wives who pretend that they wish to nurse their own children. They take care to be dissuaded from this whim. They contrive that husbands, doctors, and especially mothers should intervene. If a husband should let his wife nurse her own baby, it would be the ruin of him. They would make him out a murderer who wanted to be rid of her. A prudent husband must sacrifice paternal affection to domestic peace. Fortunately for you, there are women in the country districts more continent than your wives. You are still more fortunate if the time thus gained is not intended for another than yourself. There can be no doubt about a wife's duty, but considering the contempt in which it is held, it is doubtful whether it is not just as good for the child to be suckled by a stranger. This is a question for the doctors to settle, and in my opinion they have settled it according to the women's wishes, and for my own part, I think it is better that the child should suck the breast of a healthy nurse rather than of a petted mother, if he has any further evil to fear from her who has given him birth. Footnote. The league between the women and the doctors has always struck me as one of the oddest things in Paris. The doctor's reputation depends on the women, and by means of the doctors the women get their own way. It is easy to see what qualifications a doctor requires in Paris if he is to become celebrated. End of footnote. Ought the question, however, to be considered only from the physiological point of view? Does not the child need a mother's care as much as her milk? Other women, or even other animals, may give him the milk she denies him, but there is no substitute for a mother's love. The woman who nurses another's child in place of her own is a bad mother. How can she be a good nurse? She may become one in time. Use will overcome nature. But the child may perish 100 times before his nurse has developed a mother's affection for him. And this affection, when developed, has its drawbacks, which should make any feeling woman afraid to put her child out to nurse. Is she prepared to divide her mother's rights, or rather to abdicate them in favour of a stranger? To see her child loving another more than herself? To feel that the affection he retains for his own mother is a favour, while his love for his foster mother is a duty? For is not some affection due where there has been a mother's care? To remove this difficulty, children are taught to look down on their nurses, to treat them as mere servants. When their task is completed, the child is withdrawn or the nurse is dismissed. Her visits to her foster child are discouraged by a cold reception. After a few years, the child never sees her again. The mother expects to take her place and to repair by her cruelty the results of her own neglect. But she is greatly mistaken. She is making an ungrateful foster child, not an affectionate son. She is teaching him ingratitude, and she is preparing him to despise at a later day the mother who bore him, as he now despises his nurse. How emphatically would I speak if it were not so hopeless to keep struggling in vain on behalf of a real reform? More depends on this than you would realize. Would you restore all men to their primal duties, begin with the mothers. The results will surprise you. Every evil follows in the train of this first sin. The whole moral order is disturbed. Nature is quenched in every breast. The home becomes gloomy. The spectacle of a young family no longer stirs the husband's love and the stranger's reverence. The mother, whose children are out of sight, wins scanty esteem. There is no home life. The ties of nature are not strengthened by those of habit. Fathers, mothers, children, brothers and sisters cease to exist. They are almost strangers. How should they love one another? Each thinks of himself first. When the home is a gloomy solitude, pleasure will be sought elsewhere. But when mothers deign to nurse their own children, there will be a reform in morals. Natural feeling will revive in every heart. There will be no lack of citizens for the state. This first step by itself will restore mutual affection. The charms of home are the best antidote to vice. The noisy play of children, which we thought so trying, becomes a delight. Mother and father rely more on each other and grow dearer to one another. The marriage tie is strengthened. In the cheerful home life, the mother finds her sweetest duties and the father his pleasantest recreation. Thus, the cure of this one evil would work a widespread reformation. Nature would regain her rights. When women become good mothers, men will be good husbands and fathers. My words are vain. When we are sick of worldly pleasures, we do not return to the pleasures of the home. Women have ceased to be mothers. They do not and will not return to their duty. Could they do it if they would? The contrary custom is firmly established. Each would have to overcome the opposition of her neighbours, leagued together against the example which some have never given and others do not desire to follow. Yet there are still a few young women of good natural disposition who refuse to be the slaves of fashion and rebel against the clamour of other women who fulfil the sweet task imposed on them by nature. Would that the reward in store for them might draw others to follow their example. My conclusion is based upon plain reason and upon facts I have never seen disputed, and I venture to promise these worthy mothers the firm and steadfast affection of their husbands and the truly filial love of their children and the respect of all the world. Childbirth will be easy and will leave no ill results. Their health will be strong and vigorous, and they will see their daughters follow their example and find that example quoted as a pattern to others. No mother, no child. Their duties are reciprocal, and when ill done by the one, they will be neglected by the other. The child should love his mother before he knows what he owes her. If the voice of instinct is not strengthened by habit, it soon dies. The heart is still born. From the outset, we have strayed from the path of nature. There is another byway which may tempt our feet from the path of nature. The mother may lavish excessive care on her child instead of neglecting him. She may make an idol of him. She may develop and increase his weakness to prevent him feeling it. She wards off every painful experience in the hope of withdrawing him from the power of nature, and fails to realize that for every trifling ill from which she preserves him, the future holds in store many accidents and dangers, and that it is a cruel kindness to prolong the child's weakness when the grown man must bear fatigue. Thetis, so the story goes, plunged her son in the waters of Styx to make him invulnerable. The truth of this allegory is apparent. The cruel mothers I speak of do otherwise. They plunge their children into softness, and they are preparing suffering for them. They open the way to every kind of ill, which their children will not fail to experience after they grow up. Fix your eyes on nature. Follow the path traced by her. She keeps children at work. She hardens them by all kinds of difficulties. She soon teaches them the meaning of pain and grief. They cut their teeth and are feverish. Sharp colics bring on convulsions. They are choked by fits of coughing and tormented by worms. Evil humours corrupt the blood. Germs of various kinds ferment in it, causing dangerous eruptions. Sickness and danger play the chief part in infancy. One half of the children who are born die before their 8th year. The child who has overcome hardships has gained strength, and as soon as he can use his life, he holds it more securely. This is nature's law. Why contradict it? Do you not see that in your efforts to improve upon her handiwork, you are destroying it? Her cares are wasted. To do from without what she does within is, according to you, to increase the danger twofold. On the contrary, it is the way to avert it. Experience shows that children delicately nurtured are more likely to die. Provided we do not overdo it, there is less risk in using their strength than in sparing it. Accustom them, therefore, to the hardships they will have to face. Train them to endure extremes of temperature, climate and condition, hunger, thirst and weariness. Dip them in the waters of Styx. Before bodily habits become fixed, you may teach what habits you will without any risk. But once habits are established, any change is fraught with peril. A child will bear changes which a man cannot bear. The muscles of the one are soft and flexible, They take whatever direction you give them without any effort. The muscles of the grown man are harder, and they only change their accustomed mode of action when subjected to violence. So we can make a child strong without risking his life or health, and even if there were some risk, it should not be taken into consideration. Since human life is full of dangers, can we do better than face them at a time when they can do the least harm? A child's worth increases with his years. To his personal value must be added the cost of the care bestowed upon him. For himself, there is not only loss of life, but the consciousness of death. We must therefore think most of his future in our efforts for his preservation. He must be protected against the ills of youth before he reaches them. For if the value of life increases until the child reaches an age when he can be useful, what madness to spare some suffering in infancy, only to multiply his pain when he reaches the age of reason. Is that what our master teaches us? Man is born to suffer. Pain is the means of his preservation. His childhood is happy, knowing only pain of body. These bodily sufferings are much less cruel, much less painful than other forms of suffering, and they rarely lead to self-destruction. It is not the twinges of gout which make a man kill himself. It is mental suffering that leads to despair. We pity the sufferings of childhood. We should pity ourselves. Our worst sorrows are of our own making. The newborn infant cries. His early days are spent in crying. He is alternately petted and shaken by ways of soothing him. Sometimes he is threatened, sometimes beaten to keep him quiet. We do what he wants, or we make him do what we want. We submit to his whims, or subject him to our own. There is no middle course. He must rule or obey. Thus his earliest ideas are those of the tyrant or the slave. He commands before he can speak. He obeys before he can act. And sometimes he is punished for faults before he is aware of them, or rather before they are committed. Thus early are the seeds of evil passions sown in his young heart. At a later day these are attributed to nature, and when we have taken pains to make him bad, we lament his badness. In this way, the child passes 6 or 7 years in the hands of women, the victim of his own caprices or theirs, and after they have taught him all sorts of things, when they have burdened his memory with words he cannot understand, or things which are of no use to him, when nature has been stifled by the passions they have implanted in him, this sham article is sent to a tutor. The tutor completes the development of the germs of artificiality which he finds already well grown. He teaches him everything except self-knowledge and self-control, the arts of life and happiness. When at length this infant slave and tyrant, crammed with knowledge but empty of sense, feeble alike in mind and body, is flung upon the world, and his helplessness, his pride, and his other vices are displayed, we begin to lament the wretchedness and perversity of mankind. We are wrong. This is the creature of our fantasy. The natural man is cast in another mould. Would you keep him as nature made him? Watch over him from his birth. Take possession of him as soon as he comes into the world, and keep him till he is a man. You will never succeed otherwise. The real nurse is the mother, and the real teacher is the father. Let them agree in the ordering of their duties as well as in their method. Let the child pass from one to the other. He will be better educated by a sensible though ignorant father than by the cleverest master in the world. For zeal will atone for lack of knowledge, rather than knowledge for lack of zeal. But the duties of public and private business. Duty indeed. Does a father's duty come last? Footnote. When we read in Plutarch that Cato the censor, who ruled Rome with such glory, brought up his own sons from the cradle, and so carefully that he left everything to be present when their nurse, that is to say their mother, bathed them. When we read in Suetonius that Augustus, the master of the world which he had conquered, and which he himself governed, himself taught his grandsons to write, to swim, to understand the beginnings of science, and that he always had them with him, we cannot help smiling at the little people of those days who amused themselves with such follies, and who were too ignorant, no doubt, to attend to the great affairs of the great people of our own time. End of footnote. It is not surprising that the man whose wife despises the duty of suckling her child should despise its education. There is no more charming picture than that of family life, but when one feature is wanting, the whole is marred. If the mother is too delicate to nurse her child, the father will be too busy to teach him. Their children, scattered about in schools, convents, and colleges, will find the home of their affections elsewhere, or rather they will form the habit of caring for nothing. Brothers and sisters will scarcely know each other. When they are together in company, they will behave as strangers. When there is no confidence between relations, when the family society ceases to give savour to life, its place is soon usurped by vice. Is there any man so stupid that he cannot see how all this hangs together? A father has done but a third of his task when he begets children and provides a living for them. He owes men to humanity, citizens to the state. A man who can pay this threefold debt and neglect to do so is guilty, more guilty perhaps if he pays it in part than when he neglects it entirely. He has no right to be a father if he cannot fulfill a father's duties. Poverty, pressure of business, mistaken social prejudices, none of these can excuse a man from his duty, which is to support and educate his own children. If a man of any natural feeling neglects these sacred duties, he will repent it with bitter tears and will never be comforted. But what does this rich man do, this father of a family, compelled, so he says, to neglect his children? He pays another man to perform those duties, which are his alone. Mercenary man! Do you expect to purchase a second father for your child? Do not deceive yourself. It is not even a master you have hired for him. It is a flunky, who will soon train such another as himself. There is much discussion as to the characteristics of a good tutor. My first requirement, and it implies a good many more, is that he should not take up his task for reward. There are callings so great that they cannot be undertaken for money without showing our unfitness for them. Such callings are those of the soldier and the teacher. But who must train my child? I have just told you should do it yourself. I cannot. You cannot? Then find a friend. I see no other course. A tutor. What a noble soul. Indeed, for the training of a man, one must either be a father or more than a man. It is this duty you would calmly hand over to a hireling. The more you think of it, the harder you will find it. The tutor must have been trained for his pupil, his servants must have been trained for their master, so that all who come near him may have received the impression which is to be transmitted to him. We must pass from education to education, I know not how far. How can a child be well educated by one who has not been well educated himself? Can such a one be found? I know not. In this age of degradation, who knows the height of virtue to which man's soul may attain? But let us assume that this prodigy has been discovered. We shall learn what he should be from the consideration of his duties. I fancy the father who realizes the value of a good tutor will contrive to do without one, for it will be harder to find one than to become such a tutor himself. He need search no further, nature herself having done half the work. Someone whose rank alone is known to me suggested that I should educate his son. He did me a great honor, no doubt, but far from regretting my refusal, he ought to congratulate himself on my prudence. Had the offer been accepted, and had I been mistaken in my method, there would have been an education ruined. Had I succeeded, things would have been worse. His son would have renounced his title and refused to be a prince. I feel too deeply the importance of a tutor's duties and my own unfitness ever to accept such a post, whoever offered it, and even the claims of friendship would be only an additional motive for my refusal. Few, I think, will be tempted to make me such an offer when they have read this book, and I beg anyone who would do so to spare his pains. I have had enough experience of the task to convince myself of my own unfitness, and my circumstances would make it impossible, even if my talents were such as to fit me for it. I have thought it my duty to make this public declaration to those who apparently refuse to do me the honour of believing in the sincerity of my determination. If I am unable to undertake the more useful task, I will at least venture to attempt the easier one. I will follow the example of my predecessors and take up not the task, but my pen. And instead of doing the right thing, I will try to say it. I know that in such an undertaking, the author, who ranges at will among theoretical systems, utters many fine precepts impossible to practice. And even when he says what is practicable, it remains undone for want of details and examples as to its application. I have therefore decided to take an imaginary pupil, to assume on my own part the age, health, knowledge, and talents required for the work of his education, to guide him from birth to manhood, when he needs no guide but himself. This method seems to me useful for an author who fears lest he may stray from the practical to the visionary, for as soon as he departs from common practice, he has only to try his method on his pupil. He will soon know, or the reader will know for him, whether he is following the development of the child and the natural growth of the human heart. This is what I have tried to do. Lest my book should be unduly bulky, I have been content to state those principles, the truth of which is self-evident. But as to the rules which call for proof, I have applied them to Emile or to others, and I have shown in very great detail how my theories may be put into practice. Such, at least, is my plan. The reader must decide whether I have succeeded. At first, I have said little about Emile, for my earliest maxims of education, though very different from those generally accepted, are so plain that it is hard for a man of sense to refuse to accept them. But as I advance, my scholar, educated after another fashion than yours, is no longer an ordinary child. He needs a special system. Then he appears upon the scene more frequently, and towards the end I never lose sight of him for a moment, until, whatever he may say, he needs me no longer. I pass over the qualities required in a good tutor. I take them for granted, and assume that I am endowed with them. As you read this book, you will see how generous I have been to myself. I will only remark that, contrary to the received opinion, a child's tutor should be young, as young indeed as a man may well be who is also wise. Were it possible, he should become a child himself, that he may be the companion of his pupil, and win his confidence by sharing his games. Childhood and age have too little in common for the formation of a really firm affection. Children sometimes flatter old men. They never love them. People seek a tutor who has already educated one pupil. This is too much. One man can only educate one pupil. If two were essential to success, what right would he have to undertake the first? With more experience, you may know better what to do, but you are less capable of doing it. Once this task has been well done, you will know too much of its difficulties to attempt it a second time. If ill done, the first attempt augurs badly for the second. It is one thing to follow a young man about for 4 years, another to be his guide for 25. You find a tutor for your son when he is already formed. I want one for him before he is born. Your man may change his pupil every 5 years. Mine will never have but one pupil. You distinguish between the teacher and the tutor. Another piece of folly. Do you make any distinction between the pupil and the scholar? There is only one science for children to learn, the duties of man. This science is one, and whatever Xenophon may say of the education of the Persians, it is indivisible. Besides, I prefer to call the man who has this knowledge master rather than teacher, since it is a question of guidance rather than instruction. He must not give precepts. He must let the scholar find them out for himself. If the master is to be so carefully chosen, he may well choose his pupil, above all when he proposes to set a pattern for others. This choice cannot depend on the child's genius or character, as I adopt him before he is born, and they are only known when my task is finished. If I had my choice, I would take a child of ordinary mind, such as I assume in my pupil. It is ordinary people who have to be educated, and their education alone can serve as a pattern for the education of their fellows. The others find their way alone. The birthplace is not a matter of indifference in the education of man. It is only in temperate climes that he comes to his full growth. The disadvantages of extremes are easily seen. A man is not planted in one place like a tree. To stay there the rest of his life, and to pass from one extreme to another, you must travel twice as far as he who starts halfway. If the inhabitant of a temperate climate passes in turn through both extremes, his advantage is plain, for although he may be changed as much as he who goes from one extreme to the other, he only removes halfway from his natural condition. A Frenchman can live in New Guinea or in Lapland, but a Negro cannot live in Tonea, nor a Samoyed in Benin. It seems also as if the brain were less perfectly organized in the two extremes. Neither the Negroes nor the Laps are as wise as Europeans. So if I want my pupil to be a citizen of the world, I will choose him in the temperate zone, in France, for example, rather than elsewhere. In the north, with its barren soil, men devour much food. In the fertile south, they eat little. This produces another difference. The one is industrious, the other contemplative. Society shows us, in one and the same spot, a similar difference between rich and poor. The one dwells in a fertile land, the other in a barren land. The poor man has no need of education. The education of his own station in life is forced upon him. He can have no other. The education received by the rich man from his own station is least fitted for himself and for society. Moreover, a natural education should fit a man for any position. Now, it is more unreasonable to train a poor man for wealth than a rich man for poverty, for in proportion to their numbers, more rich men are ruined and fewer poor men become rich. Let us choose our scholar among the rich. We shall at least have made another man. The poor may come to manhood without our help. For the same reason, I should not be sorry if Emile came of a good family. He will be another victim snatched from prejudice. Emile is an orphan. No matter whether he has father or mother, having undertaken their duties, I am invested with their rights. He must honour his parents, but he must obey me. That is my first and only condition. I must add that there is just one other point arising out of this. We must never be separated, except by mutual consent. This clause is essential, and I would have tutor and scholar so inseparable that they should regard their fate as one. If once they perceive the time of their separation drawing near, the time which must make them strangers to one another, they become strangers then and there. Each makes his own little world, and both of them being busy in thought with the time when they will no longer be together, they remain together against their will. The disciple regards his master as the badge and scourge of childhood. The master regards his scholar as a heavy burden which he longs to be rid of. Both are looking forward to the time when they will part, and as there is never any real affection between them, there will be scant vigilance on the one hand, and on the other scant obedience. But when they consider they must always live together, they must needs love one another, and in this way they really learn to love one another. The pupil is not ashamed to follow as a child the friend who will be with him in manhood. The tutor takes an interest in the efforts whose fruits he will enjoy, and the virtues he is cultivating in his pupil form a store laid up for his old age. This agreement made beforehand assumes a normal birth, a strong, well-made, healthy child. A father has no choice, and should have no preference within the limits of the family God has given him. All his children are his alike. The same care and affection is due to all. Crippled or well-made, weak or strong, each of them is a trust for which he is responsible to the giver, and nature is a party to the marriage contract along with husband and wife. But if you undertake a duty not imposed upon you by nature, you must secure beforehand the means for its fulfilment, unless you would undertake duties you cannot fulfil. If you take the care of a sickly, unhealthy child, you are a sick nurse, not a tutor. To preserve a useless life, you are wasting the time which should be spent in increasing its value. You risk the sight of a despairing mother reproaching you for the death of her child, who ought to have died long ago. I would not undertake the care of a feeble, sickly child, should he live to 80 years. I want no pupil who is useless alike to himself and others, one whose sole business is to keep himself alive, one whose body is always a hindrance to the training of his mind. If I vainly lavish my care upon him, what can I do but double the loss to society by robbing it of two men instead of one? Let another tend this weakling for me. I am quite willing, I approve his charity, but I myself have no gift for such a task. I could never teach the art of living to one who needs all his strength to keep himself alive. The body must be strong enough to obey the mind. A good servant must be strong. I know that intemperance stimulates the passions. In course of time, it also destroys the body. Fasting and penance often produce the same result in an opposite way. The weaker the body, the more imperious its demands. The stronger it is, the better it obeys. All sensual passions find their home in effeminate bodies. The less satisfaction they can get, the keener their sting. A feeble body makes a feeble mind. Hence the influence of physic, an art which does more harm to man than all the evils it professes to cure. I do not know what the doctors cure us of, but I know this, they infect us with very deadly diseases, cowardice, timidity, credulity, the fear of death. What matter if they make the dead walk? We have no need of corpses. They fail to give us men, and it is men we need. Medicine is all the fashion in these days, and very naturally. It is the amusement of the idle and unemployed, who do not know what to do with their time, and so spend it in taking care of themselves. If by ill luck they had happened to be born immortal, they would have been the most miserable of men. A life they could not lose would be of no value to them. Such men must have doctors to threaten and flatter them, to give them the only pleasure they can enjoy, the pleasure of not being dead. I will say no more at present as to the uselessness of medicine. My aim is to consider its bearings on morals. Still, I cannot refrain from saying that men employ the same sophism about medicine as they do about the search for truth. They assume that the patient is cured and that the seeker after truth finds it. They fail to see that against one life saved by the doctors, you must set 100 slain, and against the value of one truth discovered, the errors which creep in with it. The science which instructs and the medicine which heals are no doubt excellent, but the science which misleads us and the medicine which kills us are evil. Teach us to know them apart. That is the real difficulty. If we were content to be ignorant of truth, we should not be the dupes of falsehood. If we did not want to be cured in spite of nature, we should not be killed by the doctors. We should do well to steer clear of both, and we should evidently be the gainers. I do not deny that medicine is useful to some men. I assert that it is fatal to mankind. You will tell me, as usual, that the doctors are to blame, that medicine herself is infallible. Well and good, then give us the medicine without the doctor, for when we have both, the blunders of the artist are 100-fold greater than our hopes from the art. This lying art, invented rather for the ills of the mind than of the body, is useless to both alike. It does less to cure us of our diseases than to fill us with alarm. It does less to ward off death than to make us dread its approach. It exhausts life rather than prolongs it. Should it even prolong life, it would only be to the prejudice of the race, since it makes us set its precautions before society and our fears before our duties. It is the knowledge of danger that makes us afraid. If we thought ourselves invulnerable, we should know no fear. The poet armed Achilles against danger, and so robbed him of the merit of courage. On such terms, any man would be an Achilles. Would you find a really brave man? Seek him where there are no doctors, where the results of disease are unknown, and where death is little thought of. By nature, a man bears pain bravely and dies in peace. It is the doctors with their rules, the philosophers with their precepts, the priests with their exhortations, who debase the heart and make us afraid to die. Give me a pupil who has no need of these, or I will have nothing to do with him. No one else shall spoil my work. I will educate him myself, or not at all. That wise man, Locke, who had devoted part of his life to the study of medicine, advises us to give no drugs to the child, whether as a precaution or on account of slight ailments. I will go farther, and will declare that, as I never call in a doctor for myself, I will never send for one for Emile, unless his life is clearly in danger, when the doctor can but kill him. I know the doctor will make capital out of my delay. If the child dies, he was called in too late. If he recovers, it is his doing. So be it. Let the doctor boast, but do not call him except in extremity. As the child does not know how to be cured, he knows how to be ill. The one art takes the place of the other and is often more successful. It is the art of nature. When a beast is ill, it keeps quiet and suffers in silence. But we see fewer sickly animals than sick men. How many men have been slain by impatience, fear, anxiety, and above all by medicine, men whom disease would have spared and time alone have cured? I shall be told that animals who live according to nature are less liable to disease than ourselves. Well, that way of living is just what I mean to teach my pupil. He should profit by it in the same way. Hygiene is the only useful part of medicine, and hygiene is rather a virtue than a science. Temperance and industry are man's true remedies. Work sharpens his appetite, and temperance teaches him to control it. To learn what system is most beneficial, you have only to study those races remarkable for health, strength, and length of days. If common observation shows us that medicine neither increases health nor prolongs life, it follows that this useless art is worse than useless, since it wastes time, men, and things on what is pure loss. Not only must we deduct the time spent, not in using life but preserving it, But if this time is spent in tormenting ourselves, it is worse than wasted. It is so much to the bad. And to reckon fairly, a corresponding share must be deducted from what remains to us. A man who lives 10 years for himself and others, without the help of doctors, lives more for himself and others than one who spends 30 years as their victim. I have tried both, so I think I have a better right than most to draw my own conclusions. For these reasons, I decline to take any but a strong and healthy pupil, and these are my principles for keeping him in health. I will not stop to prove at length the value of manual labour and bodily exercise for strengthening the health and constitution. No one denies it. Nearly all the instances of long life are to be found among the men who have taken most exercise, who have endured fatigue and labour. Footnote. I cannot help quoting the following passage from an English newspaper, as it throws much light on my opinions. A certain Patrick O'Neill, born in 1647, has just married his 7th wife, in 1760. In the 17th year of Charles II, he served in the Dragoons, and in other regiments up to 1740, when he took his discharge. He served in all the campaigns of William III and Marlborough. This man has never drunk anything but small beer. He has always lived on vegetables, and has never eaten meat, except on few occasions when he made a feast for his relations. He has always been accustomed to rise with the sun and go to bed at sunset, unless prevented by his military duties. He is now in his 130th year. He is healthy, his hearing is good, and he walks with the help of a stick. In spite of his great age, he is never idle, and every Sunday he goes to his parish church, accompanied by his children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. End of footnote. Neither will I enter into details as to the care I shall take for this alone. It will be clear that it forms such an essential part of my practice that it is enough to get hold of the idea without further explanation. When our life begins, our needs begin too. The newborn infant must have a nurse. If his mother will do her duty, so much the better. Her instructions will be given her in writing, but this advantage has its drawbacks. It removes the tutor from his charge. But it is to be hoped that the child's own interests and her respect for the person to whom she is about to confide so precious a treasure will induce the mother to follow the master's wishes, and whatever she does, you may be sure she will do better than another. If we must have a strange nurse, make a good choice to begin with. It is one of the misfortunes of the rich to be cheated on all sides. What wonder they think ill of mankind? It is riches that corrupt men, and the rich are rightly the first to feel the defects of the only tool they know. Everything is ill done for them, except what they do themselves, and they do next to nothing. When a nurse must be selected, the choice is left to the doctor. What happens? The best nurse is the one who offers the highest bribe. I shall not consult the doctor about Emile's nurse. I shall take care to choose her myself. I may not argue about it so elegantly as the surgeon, but I shall be more reliable. I shall be less deceived by my zeal than the doctor by his greed. There is no mystery about this choice. Its rules are well known, but I think we ought probably to pay more attention to the age of the milk as well as its quality. The first milk is watery. It must be almost an aperient to purge the remains of the meconium curdled in the bowels of the newborn child. Little by little, the milk thickens and supplies more solid food as the child is able to digest it. It is surely not without cause that nature changes the milk in the female of every species according to the age of the offspring. Thus, a newborn child requires a nurse who has recently become mother. There is, I know, a difficulty here, but as soon as we leave the path of nature, there are difficulties in the way of all well-doing. The wrong course is the only right one under the circumstances, so we take it. The nurse must be healthy alike in disposition and in body. The violence of the passions as well as the humours may spoil her milk. Moreover, to consider the body only is to keep only half our aim in view. The milk may be good and the nurse bad. A good character is as necessary as a good constitution. If you choose a vicious person, I do not say her foster child will acquire her vices, but he will suffer for them. Ought she not to bestow on him day by day, along with her milk, a care which calls for zeal, patience, gentleness, and cleanliness? If she is intemperate and greedy, her milk will soon be spoilt. If she is careless and hasty, what will become of a poor little wretch left to her mercy, and unable either to protect himself or to complain? The wicked are never good for anything. The choice is all the more important because her foster child should have no other guardian. just as he should have no teacher but his tutor. This was the custom of the ancients, who talked less but acted more wisely than we. The nurse never left her foster daughter. This is why the nurse is the confidant in most of their plays. A child who passes through many hands in turn can never be well brought up. At every change he makes a secret comparison, which continually tends to lessen his respect for those who control him, and with it their authority over him. If once he thinks there are grown-up people with no more sense than children, the authority of age is destroyed, and his education is ruined. A child should know no betters but its father and mother, or failing them, its foster mother and its tutor, and even this is one too many. But this division is inevitable, and the best that can be done in the way of remedy is that the man and woman who control him shall be so well agreed with regard to him that they seem like one. The nurse must live rather more comfortably. She must have rather more substantial food. But her whole way of living must not be altered, for a sudden change, even a change for the better, is dangerous to health. And since her usual way of life has made her healthy and strong, why change it? Country women eat less meat and more vegetables than townswomen, and this vegetarian diet seems favourable rather than otherwise to themselves and their children. When they take nurslings from the upper classes, they eat meat and broth with the idea that they will form better chyle and supply more milk. I do not hold with this at all, and experience is on my side, for we do not find children fed in this way less liable to colic and worms. That need not surprise us, for decaying animal matter swarms with worms, but this is not the case with vegetable matter. Footnote: women eat bread, vegetables, and dairy produce. Female dogs and cats do the same. The she-wolves eat grass. This supplies vegetable juices to their milk. There are still those species which are unable to eat anything but flesh, if such there are, which I very much doubt. End of footnote. Milk, although manufactured in the body of an animal, is a vegetable substance. This is shown by analysis. It readily turns acid, and far from showing traces of any volatile alkali like animal matter, it gives a neutral salt like plants. The milk of herbivorous creatures is sweeter and more wholesome than the milk of the carnivorous. Formed of a substance similar to its own, it keeps its goodness and becomes less liable to putrefaction. If quantity is considered, it is well known that farinaceous foods produce more blood than meat, so they ought to yield more milk. If a child were not weaned too soon, and if it were fed on vegetarian food, and its foster mother were a vegetarian, I do not think it would be troubled with worms. Milk derived from vegetable foods may perhaps be more liable to go sour, but I am far from considering sour milk an unwholesome food. Whole nations have no other food and are none the worse, and all the array of absorbents seem to me mere humbug. There are constitutions which do not thrive on milk, others can take it without absorbents. People are afraid of the milk separating or curdling. That is absurd, for we know that milk always curdles in the stomach. This is how it becomes sufficiently solid to nourish children and young animals. If it did not curdle, it would merely pass away without feeding them. Footnote: although the juices which nourish us are liquid, they must be extracted from solids. A hard-working man who ate nothing but soup would soon waste away. He would be far better fed on milk, just because it curdles. End of footnote. In vain you dilute milk and use absorbents. Whoever swallows milk digests cheese. This rule is without exception. Rennet is made from a calf's stomach. Instead of changing the nurse's usual diet, I think it would be enough to give food in larger quantities and better of its kind. It is not the nature of the food that makes a vegetable diet indigestible, but the flavouring that makes it unwholesome. Reform your cookery. Use neither butter nor oil for frying. Butter, salt, and milk should never be cooked. Let your vegetables be cooked in water and only seasoned when they come to table. The vegetable diet, far from disturbing the nurse, will give her a plentiful supply of milk. If a vegetable diet is best for the child, how can meat food be best for his nurse? The things are contradictory. Fresh air affects children's constitutions, particularly in early years. It enters every pore of a soft and tender skin. It has a powerful effect on their young bodies. Its effects can never be destroyed. So I should not agree with those who take a countrywoman from her village and shut her up in one room in a town and her nursling with her. I would rather send him to breathe the fresh air of the country than the foul air of the town. He will take his new mother's position, will live in her cottage, where his tutor will follow him. The reader will bear in mind that this tutor is not a paid servant, but the father's friend. But if this friend cannot be found, if this transfer is not easy, if none of my advice can be followed, you will say to me, "What shall I do instead?" I have told you already, do what you are doing. No advice is needed there. Men are not made to be crowded together in anthills, but scattered over the earth to till it. The more they are massed together, the more corrupt they become. Disease and vice are the sure results of overcrowded cities. Of all creatures, man is least fitted to live in herds. Huddled together like sheep, men would very soon die. Man's breath is fatal to his fellows. This is literally as well as figuratively true. Men are devoured by our towns. In a few generations, the race dies out or becomes degenerate. It needs renewal, and it is always renewed from the country. Send your children to renew themselves, so to speak. Send them to regain in the open fields the strength lost in the foul air of our crowded cities. Women hurry home that their children may be born in the town. They ought to do just the opposite, especially those who mean to nurse their own children. They would lose less than they think, and in more natural surroundings, the pleasures associated by nature with maternal duties would soon destroy the taste for other delights. The newborn infant is first bathed in warm water, to which a little wine is usually added. I think the wine might be dispensed with. As nature does not produce fermented liquors, it is not likely that they are of much value to her creatures. In the same way, it is unnecessary to take the precaution of heating the water. In fact, among many races, the newborn infants are bathed with no more ado in rivers or in the sea. Our children, made tender before birth by the softness of their parents, come into the world with a constitution already enfeebled, which cannot be at once exposed to all the trials required to restore it to health. Little by little, they must be restored to their natural vigour. Begin, then, by following this custom, and leave it off gradually. Wash your children often. Their dirty ways show the need of this. If they are only wiped, their skin is injured. But as they grow stronger, gradually reduce the heat of the water, till at last you bathe them winter and summer, in cold, even in ice-cold water. To avoid risk, this change must be slow, gradual, and imperceptible, so you may use the thermometer for exact measurements. This habit of the bath, once established, should never be broken off. It must be kept up all through life. I value it not only on grounds of cleanliness and present health, but also as a wholesome means of making the muscles supple and accustoming them to bear without risk or effort extremes of heat and cold. As he gets older, I would have the child trained to bathe occasionally in hot water of every bearable degree, and often in every degree of cold water. Now water, being a denser fluid, touches us at more points than air, so that, having learnt to bear all the variations of temperature in water, we shall scarcely feel this of the air. Footnote: children in towns are stifled by being kept indoors and too much wrapped up. Those who control them still have to learn that fresh air, far from doing them harm, will make them strong, while hot air will make them weak, will give rise to fevers, and will eventually kill them. End of footnote. When the child draws its first breath, do not confine it in tight wrappings, no cap, no bandages, nor swaddling clothes. Loose and flowing flannel wrappers, which leave its limbs free and are not too heavy to check his movements, not too warm to prevent his feeling the air. Footnote: the ancient Peruvians wrapped their children in loose swaddling bands, leaving the arms quite free. Later, they placed them unswaddled in a hole in the ground, lined with cloths, so that the lower part of the body was in the hole, and their arms were free, and they could move the head and bend the body at will without falling or hurting themselves. When they began to walk, they were enticed to come to the breast. The little Negroes are often in a position much more difficult for sucking. They cling to the mother's hip, and cling so tightly that the mother's arm is often not needed to support them. They clasp the breast with their hand and continue sucking while their mother goes on with her ordinary work. These children begin to walk at 2 months, or rather to crawl. Later on, they can run on all fours almost as well as on their feet. So says Buffon. Monsieur Buffon might also have quoted the example of England, where the senseless and barbarous swaddling clothes have become almost obsolete. End of footnote. Put him in a big cradle, well padded, where he can move easily and safely. As he begins to grow stronger, let him crawl about the room. Let him develop and stretch his tiny limbs. You will see him gain strength from day to day. Compare him with a well-swaddled child of the same age, and you will be surprised at their different rates of progress. Footnote. I say cradle, using the common word for want of a better, though I am convinced that it is never necessary and often harmful to rock children in the cradle. End of footnote. You must expect great opposition from the nurses, who find a half-strangled baby needs much less watching. Besides, his dirtiness is more perceptible in an open garment. He must be attended to more frequently. Indeed, custom is an unanswerable argument in some lands and among all classes of people. Do not argue with the nurses. Give your orders, see them carried out, and spare no pains to make the attention you prescribe easy in practice. Why not take your share in it? With ordinary nurslings, where the body alone is thought of, nothing matters so long as the child lives and does not actually die. But with us, when education begins with life, the newborn child is already a disciple, not of his tutor, but of nature. The tutor merely studies under this master and sees that his orders are not evaded. He watches over the infant, he observes it, he looks for the first feeble glimmering of intelligence, as the Muslim looks for the moment of the moon's rising in her first quarter. We are born capable of learning, but knowing nothing, perceiving nothing. The mind, bound up within imperfect and half-grown organs, is not even aware of its own existence. The movements and cries of the newborn child are purely reflex, without knowledge or will. Suppose a child born with the size and strength of manhood, entering upon life full-grown like Pallas from the brain of Jupiter. Such a child-man would be a perfect idiot, an automaton, a statue without motion and almost without feeling. He would see and hear nothing. He would recognize no one. He could not turn his eyes towards what he wanted to see. Not only would he perceive no external object, he would not even be aware of sensation through the several sense organs. His eye would not perceive color, his ear sounds. His body would be unaware of contact with neighboring bodies. He would not even know he had a body. What his hands handled would be in his brain alone. All his sensations would be united in one place. They would exist only in the common sensorium. He would have only one idea, that of self, to which he would refer all his sensations. And this idea, or rather this feeling, would be the only thing in which he excelled an ordinary child. This man, full grown at birth, would also be unable to stand on his feet. He would need a long time to learn how to keep his balance. Perhaps he would not even be able to try to do it. And you would see the big, strong body left in one place like a stone, or creeping and crawling like a young puppy. He would feel the discomfort of bodily needs without knowing what was the matter and without knowing how to provide for those needs. There is no immediate connection between the muscles of the stomach and those of the arms and legs to make him take a step towards food or stretch a hand to seize it, even were he surrounded with it. And as his body would be full grown and his limbs well developed, he would be without the perpetual restlessness and movement of childhood, so that he might die of hunger without stirring to seek food. However little you may have thought about the order and development of our knowledge, you cannot deny that such a one would be in the state of almost primitive ignorance and stupidity natural to man before he's learnt anything from experience or from his fellows. We know then, or we may know, the point of departure from which we each start towards the usual level of understanding. But who knows the other extreme? Each progresses more or less according to his genius, his taste, his needs, his talents, his zeal, and his opportunities for using them. No philosopher, so far as I know, has dared to say to man, "Thus far shalt thou go, and no further." We know not what nature allows us to be. None of us has measured the possible difference between man and man. Is there a mind so dead that this thought has never kindled it, that has never said in his pride, "How much have I already done? How much more may I achieve? Why should I lag behind my fellows?" As I said before, man's education begins at birth, before he can speak or understand he is learning. Experience precedes instruction. When he recognizes his nurse, he has learnt much. The knowledge of the most ignorant man would surprise us if we had followed his course from birth to the present time. If all human knowledge were divided into two parts, one common to all, the other peculiar to the learned, the latter would seem very small compared with the former. But we scarcely heed this general experience, because it is acquired before the age of reason. Moreover, knowledge only attracts attention by its rarity, as in algebraic equations, common factors count for nothing. Even animals learn much. They have senses and must learn to use them. They have needs. They must learn to satisfy them. They must learn to eat, walk, or fly. Quadrupeds, which can stand on their feet from the first, cannot walk for all that. From their first attempts, it is clear that they lack confidence. Canaries who escape from their cage are unable to fly, having never used their wings. Living and feeling creatures are always learning. If plants could walk, they would need senses and knowledge, else their species would die out. The child's first mental experiences are purely affective. He is only aware of pleasure and pain. It takes him a long time to acquire the definite sensations which show him things outside himself. But before these things present and withdraw themselves, so to speak, from his sight, taking size and shape for him, the recurrence of emotional experiences is beginning to subject the child to the rule of habit. You see, his eyes constantly follow the light, and if the light comes from the side, the eyes turn towards it, so that one must be careful to turn his head towards the light, lest he should squint. He must also be accustomed from the first to the dark, or he will cry if he misses the light. Food and sleep, too, exactly measured, become necessary at regular intervals, and soon desire is no longer the effect of need, but of habit. Or rather, habit adds a fresh need to those of nature. You must be on your guard against this. The only habit the child should be allowed to contract is that of having no habits. Let him be carried on either arm. Let him be accustomed to offer either hand, to use one or other indifferently. Let him not want to eat, sleep, or do anything at fixed hours, nor be unable to be left alone by day or night. Prepare the way for his control of his liberty and the use of his strength by leaving his body its natural habit, by making him capable of lasting self-control, of doing all that he wills when his will is formed. As soon as the child begins to take notice, what is shown him must be carefully chosen. The natural man is interested in all new things. He feels so feeble that he fears the unknown. The habit of seeing fresh things without ill effects destroys this fear. Children brought up in clean houses where there are no spiders are afraid of spiders, and this fear often lasts through life. I never saw peasants, man, woman, or child afraid of spiders. Since the mere choice of things shown him may make the child timid or brave, why should not his education begin before he can speak or understand? I would have him accustomed to see fresh things, ugly, repulsive, and strange beasts, but little by little, and far off till he is used to them, and till having seen others handle them, he handles them himself. If in childhood he sees toads, snakes, and crayfish, he will not be afraid of any animal when he has grown up. Those who are continually seeing terrible things think nothing of them. All children are afraid of masks. I begin by showing Emile a mask with a pleasant face. Then someone puts this mask before his face. I begin to laugh. They all laugh too, and the child with them. By degrees, I accustom him to less pleasing masks, and at last, hideous ones. If I have arranged my stages skillfully, far from being afraid of the last mask, he will laugh at it as he did at the first. After that, I am not afraid of people frightening him with masks. When Hector bids farewell to Andromache, the young Astyanax, startled by the nodding plumes on the helmet, does not know his father. He flings himself weeping upon his nurse's bosom and wins from his mother a smile mingled with tears. What must be done to stay this terror? Just what Hector did, put the helmet on the ground and caress the child. In a calmer moment, one would do more. One would go up to the helmet, play with the plumes, let the child feel them. At last, the nurse would take the helmet and place it laughingly on her own head, if indeed a woman's hand dare touch the armour of Hector. If Emile must get used to the sound of a gun, I first fire a pistol with a small charge. He is delighted with this sudden flash, this sort of lightning. I repeat the process with more powder. Gradually, I add a small charge without a wad, then a larger. In the end, I accustom him to the sound of a gun, to fireworks, cannon, and the most terrible explosions. I have observed that children are rarely afraid of thunder unless the peals are really terrible and actually hurt the ear. Otherwise, this fear only comes to them when they know that thunder sometimes hurts or kills. When reason begins to cause fear, let us reassure them. By slow and careful stages, man and child learn to fear nothing. In the dawn of life, when memory and imagination have not begun to function, the child only attends to what affects its senses. His sense experiences are the raw material of thought. They should, therefore, be presented to him in fitting order, so that memory may at a future time present them in the same order to his understanding. But as he only attends to his sensations, it is enough, at first, to show him clearly the connection between these sensations and the things which cause them. He wants to touch and handle everything. Do not check these movements, which teach him invaluable lessons. Thus he learns to perceive the heat, cold, hardness, softness, weight or lightness of bodies, to judge their size and shape and all their physical properties, by looking, feeling, listening, and above all by comparing sight and touch, by judging with the eye what sensation they would cause to his hand. Footnote. Of all the senses, that of smell is the latest to develop. In children up to 2 or 3 years of age, they appear to be insensible of pleasant or unpleasant odours. In this respect, they are as indifferent, or rather as insensible, as many animals. End of footnote. It is only by movement that we learn the difference between self and not self. It is only by our own movements that we gain the idea of space. The child has not this idea, so he stretches out his hand to seize the object within his reach, or that which is 100 paces from him. You take this as a sign of tyranny, an attempt to bid the thing draw near, or to bid you bring it. Nothing of the kind. It is merely that the object first seen in his brain, then before his eyes, now seems close to his arms, and he has no idea of space beyond his reach. Be careful, therefore, to take him about, to move him from place to place, and to let him perceive the change in his surroundings, so as to teach him to judge of distances. When he begins to perceive distances, then you must change your plan, and only carry him when you please, not when he pleases. For as soon as he is no longer deceived by his senses, there is another motive for his effort. This change is remarkable and calls for explanation. The discomfort caused by real needs is shown by signs, when the help of others is required. Hence the cries of children. They often cry. It must be so. Since they are only conscious of feelings, when those feelings are pleasant, they enjoy them in silence. When they are painful, they say so in their own way and demand relief. Now, when they are awake, they can scarcely be in a state of indifference. Either they are asleep, or else they are feeling something. All our languages are the result of art. It has long been a subject of inquiry whether there ever was a natural language common to all. No doubt there is, and it is the language of children before they begin to speak. This language is inarticulate, but it has tone, stress, and meaning. The use of our own language has led us to neglect it so far as to forget it altogether. Let us study children, and we shall soon learn it afresh from them. Nurses can teach us this language. They understand all their nurslings say to them. They answer them, and keep up long conversations with them. And though they use words, these words are quite useless. It is not the hearing of the word, but its accompanying intonation that is understood. To the language of intonation is added the no less forcible language of gesture. The child uses not its weak hands, but its face. The amount of expression in these undeveloped faces is extraordinary. Their features change from one moment to another with incredible speed. You see smiles, desires, terror, come and go like lightning. Every time the face seems different. The muscles of the face are undoubtedly more mobile than our own. On the other hand, the eyes are almost expressionless. Such must be the sort of signs they use at an age when their only needs are those of the body. Grimaces are the sign of sensation. The glance expresses sentiment. As man's first state is one of want and weakness, his first sounds are cries and tears. The child feels his needs and cannot satisfy them. He begs for help by his cries. Is he hungry or thirsty? There are tears. Is he too cold or too hot? More tears. He needs movement and is kept quiet. More tears. He wants to sleep and is disturbed. He weeps. The less comfortable he is, the more he demands change. He has only one language because he has, so to say, only one kind of discomfort. In the imperfect state of his sense organs, he does not distinguish their several impressions. All ills produce one feeling of sorrow. These tears, which you think so little worthy of your attention, give rise to the first relation between man and his environment. Here is forged the first link in the long chain of social order. When the child cries, he is uneasy. He feels some need which he cannot satisfy. You watch him, seek this need, find it, and satisfy it. If you can neither find it nor satisfy it, the tears continue and become tiresome. The child is petted to quiet him. He is rocked or sung to sleep. If he is obstinate, the nurse becomes impatient and threatens him. Cruel nurses sometimes strike him. What strange lessons for him at his first entrance into life! I shall never forget seeing one of these troublesome, crying children thus beaten by his nurse. He was silent at once. I thought he was frightened, and said to myself, "This will be a servile being from whom nothing can be got but by harshness." I was wrong. The poor wretch was choking with rage. He could not breathe. He was black in the face. A moment later, there were bitter cries. Every sign of the anger, rage, and despair of this age was in his tones. I thought he would die. Had I doubted the innate sense of justice and injustice in man's heart, this one instance would have convinced me. I am sure that a drop of boiling liquid falling by chance on that child's hand would have hurt him less than that blow, slight in itself, but clearly given with the intention of hurting him. This tendency to anger, vexation, and rage needs great care. Boerhaave thinks that most of the diseases of children are of the nature of convulsions, because the head being larger in proportion and the nervous system more extensive than in adults, they are more liable to nervous irritation. Take the greatest care to remove from them any servants who tease, annoy, or vex them. They are 100-fold more dangerous and more fatal than fresh air and changing seasons. When children only experience resistance in things and never in the will of man, they do not become rebellious or passionate, and their health is better. This is one reason why the children of the poor, who are freer and more independent, are generally less frail and weakly, more vigorous than those who are supposed to be better brought up by being constantly thwarted. But you must always remember that it is one thing to refrain from thwarting them, but quite another to obey them. The child's first tears are prayers. Beware lest they become commands. He begins by asking for aid. He ends by demanding service. Thus, from his own weakness, the source of his first consciousness of dependence, springs the later idea of rule and tyranny. But as this idea is aroused rather by his needs than by our services, we begin to see moral results whose causes are not in nature. Thus we see how important it is, even at the earliest age, to discern the secret meaning of the gesture or cry. When the child tries to seize something without speaking, he thinks he can reach the object, for he does not rightly judge its distance. When he cries and stretches out his hands, he no longer misjudges the distance. He bids the object approach, or orders you to bring it to him. In the first case, bring it to him slowly. In the second, do not even seem to hear his cries. The more he cries, the less you should heed him. He must learn in good time not to give commands to men, for he is not their master, nor to things, for they cannot hear him. Thus, when the child wants something you mean to give him, it is better to carry him to it rather than to bring the thing to him. From this he will draw a conclusion suited to his age, and there is no other way of suggesting it to him. The Abbé Saint-Pierre calls men big children. One might also call children little men. These statements are true, but they require explanation. But when Hobbes calls the wicked a strong child, his statement is contradicted by facts. All wickedness comes from weakness. The child is only naughty because he is weak. Make him strong and he will be good. If we could do everything, we should never do wrong. Of all the attributes of the Almighty, goodness is that which it would be hardest to disassociate from our conception of him. All nations who have acknowledged a good and an evil power have always regarded the evil as inferior to the good, otherwise their opinion would have been absurd. Compare this with the creed of the Savoyard clergyman later on in this book. Reason alone teaches us to know good and evil. Therefore conscience, which makes us love the one and hate the other, though it is independent of reason, cannot develop without it. Before the age of reason, we do good or ill without knowing it, and there is no morality in our actions, although there is sometimes in our feeling with regard to other people's actions in relation to ourselves. A child wants to overturn everything he sees. He breaks and smashes everything he can reach. He seizes a bird as he seizes a stone, and strangles it without knowing what he is about. Why so? In the first place, philosophy will account for this by inbred sin, man's pride, love of power, selfishness, spite. Perhaps it will say in addition to this that the child's consciousness of his own weakness makes him eager to use his strength, to convince himself of it. But watch that broken-down old man reduced in the downward course of life to the weakness of a child. Not only is he quiet and peaceful, he would have all about him quiet and peaceful too. The least change disturbs and troubles him. He would like to see universal calm. How is it possible that similar feebleness and similar passions should produce such different effects in age and in infancy if the original cause were not different? And where can we find this difference in cause except in the bodily condition of the two? The active principle, common to both, is growing in one case and declining in the other. It is being formed in the one and destroyed in the other. One is moving towards life, the other towards death. The failing activity of the old man is centered in his heart. The child's overflowing activity spreads abroad. He feels, if we may say so, strong enough to give life to all about him. To make or to destroy, it is all one to him. Change is what he seeks, and all change involves action. If he seems to enjoy destructive activity, it is only that it takes time to make things and very little time to break them, so that the work of destruction accords better with his eagerness. While the author of nature has given children this activity, he takes care that it shall do little harm by giving them small power to use it. But as soon as they can think of people as tools to be used, they use them to carry out their wishes and to supplement their own weakness. This is how they become tiresome, masterful, imperious, naughty, and unmanageable, a development which does not spring from a natural love of power, but one which has been taught them, for it does not need much experience to realize how pleasant it is to set others to work and to move the world by a word. As the child grows, it gains strength and becomes less restless and unquiet and more independent. Soul and body become better balanced, and nature no longer asks for more movement than is required for self-preservation. But the love of power does not die with the need that aroused it. Power arouses and flatters self-love, and habit strengthens it. Thus caprice follows upon need, and the first seeds of prejudice and obstinacy are sown. First maxim. Far from being too strong, children are not strong enough for all the claims of nature. Give them full use of such strength as they have, they will not abuse it. Second maxim. Help them and supply the experience and strength they lack whenever the need is of the body. Third maxim. In the help you give them, confine yourself to what is really needful, without granting anything to caprice or unreason. For they will not be tormented by caprice if you do not call it into existence, seeing it is no part of nature. Fourth maxim. Study carefully their speech and gestures, so that at an age when they are incapable of deceit, you may discriminate between those desires which come from nature and those which spring from perversity. The spirit of these rules is to give children more real liberty and less power, to let them do more for themselves and demand less of others, so that by teaching them from the first to confine their wishes within the limits of their powers, they will scarcely feel the want of whatever is not in their power. This is another very important reason for leaving children's limbs and bodies perfectly free, only taking care that they do not fall, and keeping anything that might hurt them out of their way. The child whose body and arms are free will certainly cry much less than a child tied up in swaddling clothes. He who knows only bodily needs only cries when in pain, and this is a great advantage, for then we know exactly when he needs help, and if possible we should not delay our help for an instant. But if you cannot relieve his pain, stay where you are and do not flatter him by way of soothing him. Your caresses will not cure his colic, but he will remember what he must do to win them. And if he once finds out how to gain your attention at will, he is your master. The whole education is spoilt. Their movements being less constrained, children will cry less, less wearied with their tears. People will not take so much trouble to check them. With fewer threats and promises, they will be less timid and less obstinate, and will remain more nearly in their natural state. Ruptures are produced less by letting children cry than by the means taken to stop them, and my evidence for this is the fact that the most neglected children are less liable to them than others. I am very far from wishing that they should be neglected. On the contrary, it is of the utmost importance that their wants should be anticipated, so that they need not proclaim their wants by crying. But neither would I have unwise care bestowed on them. Why should they think it wrong to cry when they find they can get so much by it? When they have learned the value of their silence, they take good care not to waste it. In the end, they will so exaggerate its importance that no one will be able to pay its price. Then, worn out with crying, they become exhausted and are at length silent. Prolonged crying on the part of a child, neither swaddled nor out of health, a child who lacks nothing, is merely the result of habit or obstinacy. Such tears are no longer the work of nature, but the work of the child's nurse, who could not resist its importunity, and so has increased it, without considering that while she quiets the child today, she is teaching him to cry louder tomorrow. Moreover, when caprice or obstinacy is the cause of their tears, there is a sure way of stopping them by distracting their attention by some pleasant or conspicuous object, which makes them forget that they want to cry. Most nurses excel in this art, and rightly used, it is very useful. But it is of the utmost importance that the child should not perceive that you mean to distract his attention, and that he should be amused without suspecting you are thinking about him. Now this is what most nurses cannot do. Most children are weaned too soon. The time to wean them is when they cut their teeth. This generally causes pain and suffering. At this time, the child instinctively carries everything he gets hold of to his mouth to chew it. To help forward this process, he is given as a plaything some hard object, such as ivory or a wolf's tooth. I think this is a mistake. Hard bodies applied to the gums do not soften them. Far from it, they make the process of cutting the teeth more difficult and painful. Let us always take instinct as our guide. We never see puppies practicing their budding teeth on pebbles, iron, or bones, but on wood, leather, rags, soft materials which yield to their jaws, and on which the tooth leaves its mark. We can do nothing simply, not even for our children. Toys of silver, gold, coral, cut crystal, rattles of every price and kind, what vain and useless appliances! Away with them all! Let us have no corals or rattles. A small branch of a tree with its leaves and fruit, a stick of licorice which he may suck and chew, will amuse him as well as these splendid trifles, and they will have this advantage at least. He will not be brought up to luxury from his birth. It is admitted that pap is not a very wholesome food. Boiled milk and uncooked flour cause gravel and do not suit the stomach. In pap, the flour is less thoroughly cooked than in bread, and it has not fermented. I think bread and milk or rice cream are better. If you will have pap, the flour should be lightly cooked beforehand. In my own country, they make a very pleasant and wholesome soup from flour thus heated. Meat broth or soup is not a very suitable food and should be used as little as possible. The child must first get used to chewing his food. This is the right way to bring the teeth through, and when the child begins to swallow, the saliva mixed with the food helps digestion. I would have them first chew dried fruit or crusts. I should give them as playthings little bits of dry bread or biscuits, like the Piedmont bread, known in the country as grease. By dint of softening this bread in the mouth, some of it is eventually swallowed, the teeth come through of themselves, and the child is weaned almost imperceptibly. Peasants have usually very good digestions, and they are weaned with no more ado. From the very first, children hear spoken language. We speak to them before they can understand or even imitate spoken sounds. The vocal organs are still stiff and only gradually lend themselves to the reproduction of the sounds heard. It is even doubtful whether these sounds are heard distinctly as we hear them. The nurse may amuse the child with songs and with very merry and varied intonation, but I object to her bewildering the child with a multitude of vain words of which it understands nothing but her tone of voice. I would have the first words he hears few in number, distinctly and often repeated, while the words themselves should be related to things which can first be shown to the child. That fatal facility in the use of words we do not understand begins earlier than we think. In the schoolroom, the scholar listens to the verbiage of his master as he listened in the cradle to the babble of his nurse. I think it would be a very useful education to leave him in ignorance of both. All sorts of ideas crowd in upon us when we try to consider the development of speech and the child's first words. Whatever we do, they all learn to talk in the same way, and all philosophical speculations are utterly useless. To begin with, they have, so to say, a grammar of their own, whose rules and syntax are more general than our own. If you attend carefully, you will be surprised to find how exactly they follow certain analogies. Very much mistaken, if you like, but very regular. These forms are only objectionable because of their harshness, or because they are not recognized by custom. I have just heard a child severely scolded by his father for saying, "Mon père, irai-je-ti?" Now we see that this child was following the analogy more closely than our grammarians, for as they say to him, "Vas-y," why should he not say, "Irai-je-ti?" Notice too the skillful way in which he avoids the hiatus in irai-je or irai-je. Is it the poor child's fault that we have so unskillfully deprived the phrase of this determinative adverb I, because we did not know what to do with it? It is an intolerable piece of pedantry and most superfluous attention to detail to make a point of correcting all children's little sins against the customary expression, for they always cure themselves with time. Always speak correctly before them. Let them never be so happy with anyone as with you, and be sure that their speech will be imperceptibly modelled upon yours without any correction on your part. But a much greater evil, and one far less easy to guard against, is that they are urged to speak too much, as if people were afraid they would not learn to talk of themselves. This indiscreet zeal produces an effect directly opposite to what is meant. They speak later and more confusedly. The extreme attention paid to everything they say makes it unnecessary for them to speak distinctly. And as they will scarcely open their mouths, many of them contract a vicious pronunciation and a confused speech, which last all their life and make them almost unintelligible. I have lived much among peasants, and I never knew one of them lisp, man or woman, boy or girl. Why is this? Are their speech organs differently made from our own? No, but they are differently used. There is a hillock facing my window on which the children of the place assemble for their games. Although they are far enough away, I can distinguish perfectly what they say, and often get good notes for this book. Every day my ear deceives me as to their age. I hear the voices of children of 10. I look and see the height and features of children of 3 or 4. This experience is not confined to me. The townspeople who come to see me, and whom I consult on this point, all fall into the same mistake. This results from the fact that, up to 5 or 6, children in town, brought up in a room and under the care of a nursery governess, do not need to speak above a whisper to make themselves heard. As soon as their lips move, people take pains to make out what they mean. They are taught words which they repeat inaccurately, and by paying great attention to them, the people who are always with them rather guess what they meant to say than what they said. It is quite a different matter in the country. A peasant woman is not always with her child. He is obliged to learn to say very clearly and loudly what he wants, if he is to make himself understood. Children scattered about the fields, at a distance from their fathers, mothers, and other children, gain practice in making themselves heard at a distance, and in adapting the loudness of the voice to the distance which separates them from those to whom they want to speak. This is the real way to learn pronunciation, not by stammering out a few vowels into the ear of an attentive governess. So when you question a peasant child, he may be too shy to answer, but what he says distinctly, while the nurse must serve as interpreter for the town child. Without her, one can understand nothing of what he is muttering between his teeth. Footnote: there are exceptions to this, and often those children who at first are most difficult to hear become the noisiest when they begin to raise their voices. But if I were to enter into all these details, I should never make an end. Every sensible reader ought to see that defect and excess, caused by the same abuse, are both corrected by my method. I regard the two maxims as inseparable: always enough, never too much. When the first is well established, the latter necessarily follows on it. End of footnote. As they grow older, the boys are supposed to be cured of this fault at college, the girls in the convent schools, and indeed both usually speak more clearly than children brought up entirely at home. But they are prevented from acquiring as clear a pronunciation as the peasants in this way. They are required to learn all sorts of things by heart, and to repeat aloud what they have learnt. For when they are studying, they get into the way of gabbling and pronouncing carelessly and ill. It is still worse when they repeat their lessons. They cannot find the right words, they drag out their syllables. This is only possible when the memory hesitates, the tongue does not stammer of itself. Thus they acquire or continue habits of bad pronunciation. Later on you will see that Emile does not acquire such habits, or at least not from this cause. I grant you, uneducated people and villagers often fall into the opposite extreme. They almost always speak too loud, their pronunciation is too exact, and leads to rough and coarse articulation, their accent is too pronounced, they choose their expressions badly, etc. But to begin with, this extreme strikes me as much less dangerous than the other, for the first law of speech is to make oneself understood, and the chief fault is to fail to be understood. To pride ourselves on having no accent is to pride ourselves on ridding our phrases of strength and elegance. Emphasis is the soul of speech. It gives it its feeling and truth. Emphasis deceives less than words. Perhaps that is why well-educated people are so afraid of it. From the custom of saying everything in the same tone has arisen that of poking fun at people without their knowing it. When emphasis is prescribed, its place is taken by all sorts of ridiculous, affected, and ephemeral pronunciations, such as one observes especially among the young people about court. It is this affectation of speech and manner which makes Frenchmen disagreeable and repulsive to other nations on first acquaintance. Emphasis is found not in their speech, but in their bearing. That is not the way to make themselves attractive. All these little faults of speech, which you are so afraid the children will acquire, are mere trifles. They may be prevented or corrected with the greatest ease. But the faults which are taught them when you make them speak in a low, indistinct, and timid voice, when you are always criticizing their tone and finding fault with their words, are never cured. A man who has only learnt to speak in society of fine ladies could not make himself heard at the head of his troops and would make little impression on the rabble in a riot. First, teach the child to speak to men. He will be able to speak to the women when required. Brought up in all the rustic simplicity of the country, your children will gain a more sonorous voice. They will not acquire the hesitating stammer of town children. Neither will they acquire the expressions nor the tone of the villagers. Or if they do, they will easily lose them. Their master, being with them from their earliest years, and more in their society the older they grow, will be able to prevent or efface, by speaking correctly himself, the impression of the peasant's talk. Emile will speak the purest French I know, but he will speak it more distinctly and with a better articulation than myself. The child who is trying to speak should hear nothing but words he can understand, nor should he say words he cannot articulate. His efforts lead him to repeat the same syllable as if he were practicing its clear pronunciation. When he begins to stammer, do not try to understand him. To expect to be always listened to is a form of tyranny which is not good for the child. See carefully to his real needs, and let him try to make you understand the rest. Still less should you hurry him into speech. He will learn to talk when he feels the want of it. It has indeed been remarked that those who begin to speak very late never speak so distinctly as others. But it is not because they talked late that they are hesitating. On the contrary, they began to talk late because they hesitate. If not, why did they begin to talk so late? Have they less need of speech? Have they been less urged to it? On the contrary, the anxiety aroused with the first suspicion of this backwardness leads people to tease them much more to begin to talk than those who articulated earlier. And this mistaken zeal may do much to make their speech confused, when, with less haste, they might have had time to bring it to greater perfection. Children who are forced to speak too soon have no time to learn either to pronounce correctly or to understand what they are made to say. While left to themselves, they first practice the easiest syllables, and then, adding to them little by little some meaning which their gestures explain, they teach you their own words before they learn yours. By this means, they do not acquire your words till they have understood them. Being in no hurry to use them, they begin by carefully observing the sense in which you use them, and when they are sure of them, they adopt them. The worst evil resulting from the precocious use of speech by young children is that we not only fail to understand the first words they use, we misunderstand them without knowing it, so that while they seem to answer us correctly, they fail to understand us and we them. This is the most frequent cause of our surprise at children's sayings. We attribute to them ideas which they did not attach to their words. This lack of attention on our part to the real meaning which words have for children seems to me the cause of their earliest misconceptions. And these misconceptions, even when corrected, colour their whole course of thought for the rest of their life. I shall have several opportunities of illustrating these by examples later on. Let the child's vocabulary, therefore, be limited. It is very undesirable that he should have more words than ideas, that he should be able to say more than he thinks. One of the reasons why peasants are generally shrewder than townsfolk is, I think, that their vocabulary is smaller. They have few ideas, but those few are thoroughly grasped. The infant is progressing in several ways at once. He is learning to talk, eat, and walk about the same time. This is really the first phase of his life. Up till now, he was little more than he was before birth. He had neither feeling nor thought. He was barely capable of sensation. He was unconscious of his own existence. Vivit et est vitae nescius ipse suae. Man lives in ignorance of his own life. Ovid. Book 2. We have now reached the second phase of life. Infancy, strictly so called, is over, for the words infans, baby, and puer, boy, are not synonymous. The latter includes the former, which means, literally, one who cannot speak. Thus Valerius speaks of puerum infantum, baby boy. But I shall continue to use the word child, French enfant, according to the custom of our language, till an age for which there is another term. When children begin to talk, they cry less. This progress is quite natural. One language supplants another. As soon as they can say, "It hurts me," why should they cry, unless the pain is too sharp for words? If they still cry, those about them are to blame. When once Emile has said, "It hurts me," it will take a very sharp pain to make him cry. If the child is delicate and sensitive, if by nature he begins to cry for nothing, I let him cry in vain, and soon check his tears at their source. So long as he cries, I will not go near him. I come at once when he leaves off crying. He will soon be quiet when he wants to call me, or rather he will utter a single cry. Children learn the meaning of signs by their effects. They have no other meaning for them. However much a child hurts himself when he is alone, he rarely cries unless he expects to be heard. Should he fall or bump his head, or make his nose bleed, or cut his fingers, I shall show no alarm, nor shall I make any fuss over him. I shall take no notice, at any rate at first. The harm is done, he must bear it. All my zeal could only frighten him more and make him more nervous. Indeed, it is not the blow, but the fear of it, which distresses us when we are hurt. I shall spare him this suffering at least, for he will certainly regard the injury as he sees me regard it. If he finds that I hasten anxiously to him, if I pity him or comfort him, he will think he is badly hurt. If he finds I take no notice, he will soon recover himself, and will think the wound is healed when it ceases to hurt. This is the time for his first lesson in courage, and by bearing slight ills without fear, we gradually learn to bear greater. I shall not take pains to prevent Emile hurting himself. Far from it, I should be vexed if he never hurt himself, if he grew up unacquainted with pain. To bear pain is his first and most useful lesson. It seems as if children were small and weak on purpose to teach them these valuable lessons without danger. The child has such a little way to fall, he will not break his leg. If he knocks himself with a stick, he will not break his arm. If he seizes a sharp knife, he will not grasp it tight enough to make a deep wound. So far as I know, no child, left to himself, has ever been known to kill or maim itself, or even to do itself any serious harm, unless it has been foolishly left on a high place, or alone near the fire, or within reach of dangerous weapons. What is there to be said for all the paraphernalia with which the child is surrounded to shield him on every side, so that he grows up at the mercy of pain, with neither courage nor experience, so that he thinks he is killed by a pinprick and faints at the sight of blood? With our foolish and pedantic methods, we are always preventing children from learning what they could learn much better by themselves, while we neglect what we alone can teach them. Can anything be sillier than the pains taken to teach them to walk, as if there were anyone who was unable to walk when he grows up through his nurse's neglect? How many we see walking badly all their life because they were ill-taught? Emile shall have no head pads, no go-karts, no leading strings, or at least as soon as he can put one foot before another, he shall only be supported along pavements, and he shall be taken quickly across them. Footnote. There is nothing so absurd and hesitating as the gait of those who have been kept too long in leading strings when they were little. This is one of the observations which are considered trivial because they are true. End of footnote. Instead of keeping him mewed up in a stuffy room, take him out into a meadow every day. Let him run about. Let him struggle and fall again and again, the oftener the better. He will learn all the sooner to pick himself up. The delights of liberty will make up for many bruises. My pupil will hurt himself oftener than yours, but he will always be merry. Your pupils may receive fewer injuries, but they are always thwarted, constrained, and sad. I doubt whether they are any better off. As their strength increases, children have also less need for tears. They can do more for themselves. They need the help of others less frequently. With strength comes the sense to use it. It is with this second phase that the real personal life has its beginning. It is then that the child becomes conscious of himself. During every moment of his life, memory calls up the feeling of self. He becomes really one person, always the same, and therefore capable of joy or sorrow. Hence, we must begin to consider him as a moral being. Although we know approximately the limits of human life and our chances of attaining those limits, nothing is more uncertain than the length of the life of any one of us. Very few reach old age. The chief risks occur at the beginning of life. The shorter our past life, the less we must hope to live. Of all the children who are born, scarcely one half reach adolescence, and it is very likely your pupil will not live to be a man. What is to be thought, therefore, of that cruel education which sacrifices the present to an uncertain future, that burdens a child with all sorts of restrictions and begins by making him miserable in order to prepare him for some far-off happiness which he may never enjoy? Even if I considered that education wise in its aims, how could I view without indignation those poor wretches subjected to an intolerable slavery and condemned like galley slaves to endless toil, with no certainty that they will gain anything by it? The age of harmless mirth is spent in tears, punishments, threats, and slavery. You torment the poor thing for his good. You fail to see that you are calling death to snatch him from these gloomy surroundings. Who can say how many children fall victims to the excessive care of their fathers and mothers? They are happy to escape from this cruelty. This is all that they gain from the ills they are forced to endure. They die without regretting, having known nothing of life but its sorrows. Men, be kind to your fellow men. This is your first duty. Kind to every age and station. Kind to all that is not foreign to humanity. What wisdom can you find that is greater than kindness? Love childhood, indulge its sports, its pleasures, its delightful instincts. Who has not sometimes regretted that age when laughter was ever on the lips, and when the heart was ever at peace? Why rob these innocents of the joys which pass so quickly, of that precious gift which they cannot abuse? Why fill with bitterness the fleeting days of early childhood, days which will no more return for them than for you? Fathers, can you tell when death will call your children to him? Do not lay up sorrow for yourselves by robbing them of the short span which nature has allotted to them. As soon as they are aware of the joy of life, let them rejoice in it. Go that whenever God calls them, they may not die without having tasted the joy of life. How people will cry out against me! I hear from afar the shouts of that false wisdom which is ever dragging us onwards, counting the present as nothing, and pursuing without a pause a future which flies as we pursue, that false wisdom which removes from us our place and never brings us to any other. Now is the time, you say, to correct his evil tendencies. We must increase suffering in childhood, when it is less keenly felt, to lessen it in manhood. But how do you know that you carry out all these fine schemes? How do you know that all this fine teaching, with which you overwhelm the feeble mind of the child, will not do him more harm than good in the future? How do you know that you can spare him anything by the vexations you heap upon him now? Why inflict on him more ills than befit his present condition, unless you are quite sure that these present ills will save him future ill? And what proof can you give me that those evil tendencies you profess to cure are not the result of your foolish precautions rather than of nature? What a poor sort of foresight, to make a child wretched in the present, with the more or less doubtful hope of making him happy at some future day. If such blundering thinkers fail to distinguish between liberty and license, between a merry child and a spoiled darling, let them learn to discriminate. Let us not forget what befits our present state in the pursuit of vain fancies. Mankind has its place in the sequence of things. Childhood has its place in the sequence of human life. The man must be treated as a man, and the child as a child. Give each his place, and keep him there. Control human passions according to man's nature. That is all we can do for his welfare. The rest depends on external forces, which are beyond our control. Absolute good and evil are unknown to us. In this life, they are blended together. We never enjoy any perfectly pure feeling, nor do we remain for more than a moment in the same state. The feelings of our minds, like the changes in our bodies, are in a continual flux. Good and ill are common to all, but in varying proportions. The happiest is he who suffers least. The most miserable is he who enjoys least. Ever more sorrow than joy, this is the lot of all of us. Man's happiness in this world is but a negative state. It must be reckoned by the fewness of his ills. Every feeling of hardship is inseparable from the desire to escape from it. Every idea of pleasure from the desire to enjoy it. All desire implies a want, and all wants are painful. Hence our wretchedness consists in the disproportion between our desires and our powers. A conscious being whose powers were equal to his desires would be perfectly happy. What then is human wisdom? Where is the path of true happiness? The mere limitation of our desires is not enough, for if they were less than our powers, part of our faculties would be idle, and we should not enjoy our whole being. Neither is the mere extension of our powers enough, for if our desires were also increased, we should only be the more miserable. True happiness consists in decreasing the difference between our desires and our powers, in establishing a perfect equilibrium between the power and the will. Then only, when all its forces are employed, will the soul be at rest, and man will find himself in his true position. In this condition, nature, who does everything for the best, has placed him from the first. To begin with, she gives him only such desires as are necessary for self-preservation, and such powers as are sufficient for their satisfaction. All the rest she has stored in his mind as a sort of reserve, to be drawn upon at need. It is only in this primitive condition that we find the equilibrium between desire and power, and then alone man is not unhappy. As soon as his potential powers of mind begin to function, imagination, more powerful than all the rest, awakes and precedes all the rest. It is imagination which enlarges the bounds of possibility for us, whether for good or ill, and therefore stimulates and feeds desires by the hope of satisfying them. But the object which seemed within our grasp flies quicker than we can follow. When we think we have grasped it, it transforms itself and is again far ahead of us. We no longer perceive the country we have traversed, and we think nothing of it. That which lies before us becomes vaster and stretches still before us. Thus we exhaust our strength, yet never reach our goal, and the nearer we are to pleasure, the further we are from happiness. On the other hand, the more nearly a man's condition approximates to this state of nature, the less difference is there between his desires and his powers, and happiness is therefore less remote. Lacking everything, he is never less miserable, for misery consists not in the lack of things, but in the needs which they inspire. The world of reality has its bounds. The world of imagination is boundless. As we cannot enlarge the one, let us restrict the other, for all the sufferings which rarely make us miserable arise from the difference between the real and the imaginary. Health, strength, and a good conscience accepted, all the good things of life are a matter of opinion. Except bodily suffering and remorse, all our woes are imaginary. You will tell me this is commonplace. I admit it, but its practical application is no commonplace, and it is with practice only that we are now concerned. What do you mean when you say, man is weak? The term weak implies a relation of the creature to whom it is applied. An insect or a worm whose strength exceeds its needs is strong. An elephant, a lion, a conqueror, a hero, a god himself whose needs exceed his strength is weak. The rebellious angel who fought against his own nature was weaker than the happy mortal who is living at peace according to nature. When man is content to be himself, he is strong indeed. When he strives to be more than man, he is weak indeed. but do not imagine that you can increase your strength by increasing your powers. Not so. If your pride increases more rapidly, your strength is diminished. Let us measure the extent of our sphere and remain in its centre like the spider in its web. We shall have strength sufficient for our needs. We shall have no cause to lament our weakness, for we shall never be aware of it. The other animals possess only such powers as are required for self-preservation. Man alone has more. Is it not very strange that this superfluity should make him miserable? In every land, a man's labour yields more than a bare living. If he were wise enough to disregard this surplus, he would always have enough, for he would never have too much. Great needs, said Favorin, spring from great wealth, and often the best way of getting what we want is to get rid of what we have. By striving to increase our happiness, we change it into wretchedness. If a man were content to live, he would live happy. He would therefore be good, for what would he have to gain by vice? If we were immortal, we should all be miserable. No doubt it is hard to die, but it is sweet to think that we shall not live forever, and that a better life will put an end to the sorrows of this world. If we had the offer of immortality here below, who would accept the sorrowful gift? Footnote. You understand I am speaking of those who think, and not of the crowd. End of footnote. What resources, what hopes, what consolation would be left against the cruelties of fate and man's injustice? The ignorant man never looks before. He knows little of the value of life and does not fear to lose it. The wise man sees things of greater worth and prefers them to it. Half knowledge and sham wisdom set us thinking about death and what lies beyond it, and they thus create the worst of our ills. The wise man bears life's ills all the better because he knows he must die. Life would be too dearly bought did we not know that sooner or later death will end it. Our moral ills are the result of prejudice, crime alone excepted, and that depends on ourselves. Our bodily ills either put an end to themselves or to us. Time or death will cure them, but the less we know how to bear it, the greater is our pain, and we suffer more in our efforts to cure our diseases than if we endured them. Live according to nature. Be patient. Get rid of the doctors. You will not escape death, but you will only die once, while the doctors make you die daily through your diseased imagination. Their lying art, instead of prolonging your days, robs you of all delight in them. I am always asking what real good this art has done to mankind. True, the doctors cure some who would have died, but they kill millions who would have lived. If you are wise, you will decline to take part in this lottery when the odds are so great against you. Suffer, die, or get better, but whatever you do, live while you are alive. Human institutions are one mass of folly and contradiction. As our life loses its value, we set a higher price upon it. The old regret life more than the young. They do not want to lose all they have spent in preparing for its enjoyment. At 60, it is cruel to die when one has not begun to live. Man is credited with a strong desire for self-preservation, and this desire exists, but we fail to perceive that this desire, as felt by us, is largely the work of man. In a natural state, man is only eager to preserve his life while he has the means for its preservation. When self-preservation is no longer possible, he resigns himself to his fate and dies without vain torments. Nature teaches us the first law of resignation. Savages, like wild beasts, make very little struggle against death and meet it almost without a murmur. When this natural law is overthrown, reason establishes another, but few discern it, and man's resignation is never so complete as nature's. Prudence. Prudence, which is ever bidding us look forward into the future, a future which in many cases we shall never reach, here is the real source of all our troubles. How mad it is for so short-lived a creature as man to look forward into a future to which he rarely attains, while he neglects the present, which is his. This madness is all the more fatal since it increases with years, and the old, always timid, prudent, and miserly, prefer to do without necessaries today that they may have luxuries at 100. Thus we grasp everything, we cling to everything, we are anxious about time, place, people, things, all that is and will be. We ourselves are but the least part of ourselves. We spread ourselves, so to speak, over the whole world, and all this vast expanse becomes sensitive. No wonder our woes increase when we may be wounded on every side. how many princes make themselves miserable for the loss of lands they never saw, and how many merchants lament in Paris over some misfortune in the Indies. Is it nature that carries men so far from their real selves? Is it her will that each should learn his fate from others, and even be the last to learn it, so that a man dies happy or miserable before he knows what he is about? There is a healthy, cheerful, strong, and vigorous man. It does me good to see him. His eyes tell of content and well-being. He is the picture of happiness. A letter comes by post. The happy man glances at it. It is addressed to him. He opens it and reads it. In a moment he is changed. He turns pale and falls into a swoon. When he comes to himself, he weeps, laments, and groans. He tears his hair, and his shrieks re-echo through the air. You would say he was in convulsions. Fool, what harm has this bit of paper done you? What limb has it torn away? What crime has it made you commit? What change has it wrought in you to reduce you to this state of misery? Had the letter miscarried, had some kindly hand thrown it into the fire, it strikes me that the fate of this mortal, at once happy and unhappy, would have offered us a strange problem. His misfortunes, you say, were real enough. Granted, but he did not feel them. What of that? His happiness was imaginary.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.